Crisis. I'm your host, Jeff Williams. We're here for another action-packed episode on what is pretty much the fastest hour on television every single week. And I'm so glad that you're watching us today. And don't forget, you can always catch all of our episodes on YouTube, youtube.com/NorthStarOasis. Now, if you've been a regular viewer of the show in the last number of weeks, you'll know that we start off the top of the show with a discussion from Dennis Prager with Prager University on the Ten Commandments. And so we're going to continue that series, and we're going to go right to it. Today is number 7, do not commit adultery. Here's Dennis Prager.
There's an old joke about the seventh commandment, do not commit adultery. Moses comes down from Mount Sinai and announces, I have good news and bad news. The good news is that I got him down to 10. The bad news is that adultery stays. The joke is telling. The prohibition on a married person having sexual relations with anyone except his or her spouse may be, for many people, the most consistently difficult of the Ten Commandments to observe. The reasons shouldn't be hard to guess. One is the enormous power of the sex drive. It can be very hard to keep in check for the entirety of one's marriage, especially when an attractive outsider makes him or herself sexually or romantically available. Another reason is the human desire to love and be loved. For normal people, there is no more powerful emotion than love. If one falls in love with someone while married, it takes great effort not to commit adultery with that person. And if we add in the unfortunate circumstance of a loveless marriage, adultery becomes even more difficult to resist. That's why the joke with which I began is funny, because it reflects truth. Why is adultery prohibited in the Ten Commandments? Because, like the other 9, it is indispensable to forming and maintaining higher civilization. Adultery threatens the very building block of the civilization that the Ten Commandments seeks to create. That building block is the family, a married father and mother and their children. Anything that threatens the family unit is prohibited in the Bible. Adultery is one example. Not honoring one's father and mother is another. And the prohibition on injecting any sexuality into the family unit, incest, is a third example. Why is the family so important? Because without it, social stability is impossible. Because without it, the passing on of society's values from generation to generation is impossible. Because commitment to a wife and children makes men more responsible and mature. Because more than anything else, family meets most women's deepest emotional and material needs. And nothing comes close to the family in giving children a secure and stable childhood. And why does adultery threaten the family? The most obvious reason is that sex with someone other than one spouse can all too easily lead to either or both spouses leaving the marriage. Adultery should not automatically lead to divorce, but it often does. There is another reason adultery can destroy a family. It can lead to pregnancy and then to the birth of a child. That child will, in almost all cases, start out life with no family, meaning no father and mother married to each other to call his or her own. And if adultery doesn't destroy a family, it almost always does terrible harm to a marriage. Aside from the sense of betrayal and loss of trust that it causes, it means that the adulterous partner lives a fraudulent life. When a husband or wife is having sex with someone other than their spouse, their thoughts are constantly about that other person and about how to deceive their spouse. The life of deception that an adulterous affair necessarily entails inevitably damages a marriage, even if the betrayed spouse is unaware of the affair. Finally, the commandment prohibiting adultery doesn't come with an asterisk saying that adultery is okay if both spouses agree to it. Spouses who have extramarital sex with the permission of their husband or wife may not necessarily be hurting their spouse's feelings, but they are still harming the institution of marriage. And protecting the family, not protecting spouses from emotional pain, is the reason for the commandment. Many marriages, sadly, are troubled. And it is not for any of us to stand in judgment of others' behavior in this realm. No one knows what goes on in anyone else's marriage. And if we did, we might often well understand why one or the other sought love outside the marriage. But no higher civilization can be made or can endure that condones adultery. That is why it is prohibited in the Ten Commandments. I'm Dennis Prager. Join Prager University.
And there you have it. Another reason why we should be obeying Commandment number 7. Thanks to Dennis Prager, Prager University. Now moving on, we're going to take a look briefly at something that happened 74 years ago on Monday. And that is, if you go back a couple of weeks on our show, we had covered the USS Oklahoma at Pearl Harbor. It was a really good episode, actually. But right after Pearl Harbor, something happened in the United States response, and that was the Doolittle Raid. And on April 18th, 1942, B-25 bombers were launched off the USS Hornet aircraft carrier, and they made a one-way flight over Tokyo. It was magnified in the film 30 Seconds Over Tokyo and the last part of the film Pearl Harbor from 2001. But that incident, it occurred 74 years ago on Monday, and let's take a look at a little recap of the Doolittle Raid.
There are moments and there are men that galvanize a nation and change history. The weeks following the attack on Pearl Harbor were met with disaster for the United States in the Pacific theater of World War II. Ships were sunk, planes were lost, and troops were forced to surrender. Morale among the military and Americans at home was astoundingly low. Just before Christmas 1941, President Roosevelt expressed his desire to the Joint Chiefs that Japan be bombed as soon as possible to prove to the Imperial Japanese and to Americans that they were not invincible. Hitting Japan would not be easy. The American fleet was reeling, and Japan's defenses were strong. U.S. Army bombers would need to be specifically outfitted not only to launch from aircraft carriers, but to have sufficient range to fly over Japan and onto safety in China. Only one man could be trusted to plan such a challenging mission, the military's best aeronautical engineer, the famous test pilot, Lieutenant Colonel Jimmy Doolittle. On April 18, 1942, Doolittle led 16 B-25 bombers launched from the USS Hornet toward Japan. Each of the 80 men who flew with Doolittle knew that this was likely a suicide mission. Not only did they face Japanese anti-aircraft defenses, after being spotted, they were forced to launch their planes 200 miles early. Even if they made it to Japan, there was now no guarantee they would have enough fuel to reach safety in China. All 16 bombers reached Japan, hitting military targets in Tokyo and several other cities. Short on fuel, each of the crews were forced to bail out or crash land their planes. One landed in Russia, where its crew was interned. Three men died evacuating their planes. Eight were captured by the Japanese and held prisoner. Three were executed, and one died in captivity. The rest of the raiders regrouped and made their way to safety. Doolittle himself thought the raid was a failure, having caused minimal damage and losing all of his planes. He expected to be court-martialed. Little did Doolittle and his men know that the raid had caused a sensation back home. Morale shot through the roof as the American public, reeling from defeat after defeat, watched as the U.S. military had struck at the heart of the Japanese Empire. Just as important, the Japanese military, shocked by the attack, reorganized its defenses, diverting material to defend the home islands. This would have a huge impact 2 months later, as the entire tide of the World War shifted in the Americans' favor following the epic Battle of Midway. Jimmy Doolittle would receive the Medal of Honor for leading the raid on Tokyo. Each of the 79 other raiders were awarded the Distinguished Flying Cross, and the Doolittle Tokyo Raiders would go down in history among the most legendary veterans of the Second World War. 80 men took part in the Doolittle Raid. 62 would survive World War II. Beginning in 1946, just after the war, the surviving raiders gathered each April 18th to commemorate the raid and to honor those lost comrades. In the 1950s, they were presented with a set of 80 silver goblets, each inscribed with the name of a Doolittle Tokyo Raider. Each year, in a solemn ceremony, the Raiders have held a toast to those who died during the preceding year, turning over that Raider's goblet in its wooden carrying case. Doolittle himself passed away in 1993. Today, only four goblets remain upright. For decades, that case held a bottle of Hennessy cognac from 1896, the year of Jimmy Doolittle's birth. For half a century, the men of the Doolittle Raid held on to this bottle, agreeing it was only to be opened for one final toast when few remained, commemorating their lost brothers and marking their last official act. That act came the weekend of Veterans Day, 2013. At the National Museum of the United States Air Force. In a special ceremony, three of the four surviving Raiders, Lieutenant Colonel Richard Cole, Lieutenant Colonel Edward Saylor, and Staff Sergeant David Thatcher, came together and in a moment nearly 71 years in the making, opened that bottle of 1896 Hennessy, toasted their brothers in arms, and completed their final mission.
The Minneapolis.
Well, that was their final mission, but there are still two who are remaining. There were four at the time that video was cut. Staff Sergeant David Thatcher and Lieutenant Colonel Richard Cole are the only two remaining Doolittle Raiders. I had the tremendous honor and opportunity to meet Lieutenant Colonel Cole about 2 years ago, and I was just really awestruck with his sharp mind. He's still, at 100 years of age, he still has a pretty active schedule. And that just shows the kind of fortitude that these men had, that nothing stopped them. And with two of them left, we're running out of their legacy. You know, their legacy is about to expire. But we still have to pause to pay respect to their mission 74 years ago. Now, when we take a look at what happened with World War II, it was a different era, different time, completely different time frame. But we look at how is society now. Now, last week we had covered the Minneapolis City Council's plastic bag ban. And we're actually going to revisit that because there was somewhere I was going to go with that, but then we just ran out of time. And that's what happens when this is the fastest hour on television. So we're going to take a look at the possible solution. Instead of banning plastic bags, what can we do? We touched just a little bit about this last week. You can go back to youtube.com/NorthStarOasis. Watch last week's episode to get our full discussion, because we're just going to wrap it up now. And in this discussion, I'm going to bring on Dr. Shaun Williams-Wyche from Metropolitan State University. He's a political science professor. And Shaun, welcome to North Star Oasis. Glad to have you.
Thank you for having me, Jeff, this afternoon.
So we're going to show you right now the video that we had shown you last week. It's just under 2 minutes. And this is the Minneapolis City Council from 2 weeks ago when they banned plastic bags.
The Minneapolis City Council just passed an ordinance that will change the way businesses bag customer purchases.
It bans the use of plastic bags and charges a fee for paper bags. Ashley Roberts joins us live in downtown Minneapolis with more on this story. Ashley?
Allie, City Councilors Cam Gordon and Abdi Warsami first introduced this ordinance to reduce waste and litter in the city. After more than an hour of debating this issue and raising more questions than answers, it seemed as though council would postpone its decision, but the ordinance eventually passed. So here's what it means exactly. It means that plastic bags used to pack customers' purchases at checkouts will be banned in Minneapolis. Paper bags would also have restrictions. The paper would have to be made of recyclable material, and customers who choose paper paper bags would be charged at least a 5-cent fee. However, shoppers who take their own reusable bags to the grocery store would get at least a 10-cent credit. Council says plastic bags used for fast food, dry cleaning, and newspapers would be a few of the exceptions under the ordinance. Go ahead and take a listen to some of the back and forth we heard before it passed.
When we had our public hearing on this, almost everybody was in favor of this ordinance. They came in and spoke strongly in favor of it.
If this ordinance were to pass, thinking about just how much business we would force to go out of Minneapolis. A study in Austin, Texas states that one store lost over $60,000 per week.
The ordinance is expected to start next April. However, that could change. Several city departments have been asked to research ways to implement this ordinance and enforce it. They'll report their findings to council by January and then go from there.
Ashley Roberts live for us in downtown Minneapolis. Thank you, Ashley.
52 shopping days till Christmas. And if plastic bags are eliminated from shoppers' ability, it's going to be really difficult to actually do Christmas shopping in downtown Minneapolis. Now, the question that we ask just about every guest, with 252 shopping days left until Christmas, what is your favorite Christmas memory? And what was your favorite Christmas present growing up?
My favorite Christmas memory would probably be the first White Christmas I ever saw.
And that was when?
That would be 2010.
Okay, now I know you're a Texan, yes. Right? They don't have any snow in Texas at all?
Just only in the panhandle every now and then it might snow or sleet two or three times during the winter, but snow goes away pretty fast after that.
So when you had your first White Christmas, what did that feel like for you?
Felt like I was in a movie.
Good way or bad way?
Good way. You don't see many horror movies set around Christmas.
Well, they did have Krampus last year.
Oh.
So now what's your favorite Christmas present?
Probably have to go way back. Getting a Sega Genesis back when I was 11.
Okay.
Because that was a thing back then. That was the PlayStation, iPad games, computer games, everything rolled into one. And so that was the outlet that we had as youth back then. So
now, moving into the discussion, the plastic bag ban in Minneapolis. As a political science professor, what do you think about that?
Well, there's a few things that we need to keep in mind with this whole plastic versus paper debate. And there is no easy answer for this. And right now, the Minneapolis City Council has tried to make an easy solution for what is undoubtedly a complicated issue. And so what we see is this wave of criticism against plastic bags, mainly for the reasons that they have become tumble bags, where they constantly litter our streets with garbage, and they have just become an eyesore more and more for people. And I want to go back a second and talk about why, also other reasons why people are up in arms about plastic bags. One is that, along with it getting stuck on things, being in the roads, it's dangerous for animals. Critics of plastic bags say because they eat it, and oftentimes you might end up starving to death. And plastic bags have become difficult to recycle because a lot of machines can't handle it. Minneapolis, for example, doesn't even recycle plastic bags.
Well, we're going to actually talk about that here in just
yes.
a moment.
Yep. And so now I want to get back to paper bags, because that's the main alternative to plastic bags. But we're thinking less and less these days, as we did 25 years ago, about paper bags, because one of the biggest arguments about paper bags back then was that it was bad for the environment by cutting down trees. But that's only one aspect of what paper bags do, at least to the environment. One, they actually are worse for air pollution than plastic bags. They lead to 70% more air pollution than it takes to manufacture a plastic bag, and it emits more greenhouse gases in its manufacturing than plastic bags does. And when you are cutting the trees, you're also reducing the number of trees that could be used to absorb the carbon dioxide that comes out of the manufacture of paper bags.
Well, let's take a look right now at how a plastic bag is manufactured, because a lot of people have never seen that process. Now, last week we had discussed pretty intently on the process of manufacturing plastic in general, and I had a discussion about polymers and monomers. So now let's take a look specifically to how plastic bags are manufactured.
The process begins by chemically changing propane gas into an ethylene monomer in a cracking furnace. The ethylene monomer is then polymerized in a high-pressure reactor that results in making molten low-density polyethylene. While still in the molten state, the LDPE is compounded with additives and then pelletized into the final product. The pellets, called resin, are delivered in bulk hopper rail cars or bulk truck shipments. Upon arrival, the resin is transferred to silos for storage, then dispensed to Gaylords for us to use as needed. Colors may be added together with UV inhibitors and other additives to custom blend the finished product. The resins are mixed, blended, and placed in the hoppers at the back of the extruder tank. Here they are fed through an electrically heated barrel, which compresses and melts the materials. During the process, plastic is heated, compressed, and forced out of a circular die at over 400 degrees and at 2 to 6,000 pounds of pressure per square inch. Air is added into the tube through the center of the die. Cool air is blown onto the outside of the bubble to cool it and pull it into shape. The height of the tower is used to let the material cool to room temperature. At the top of the tower, the tube is collapsed and brought back down to where it's wound up onto rolls. After the tubing is cooled, collapsed, and brought down the tower, several things can be done to it. For example, single wound sheeting is made by trimming the edges of the tube, allowing the material to be separated to two sheets and wound onto rolls. At a predetermined footage, the rolls are removed from the machine where samples are taken from each roll. They are checked for size and mill accuracy. Rolls are weighted, recorded, and boxed, and palletized as required for shipment. During the manufacture of the plastic film, some scrap is generated. Most of this scrap is recycled on site and used for industrial or liner grade bags. Quality control is practiced at each stage of the process to ensure customer satisfaction.
How a plastic bag is manufactured. Your thoughts on the video that we had just seen?
Again, this show...
A lot of jobs there.
Yes, there are. And again, we really don't recycle plastic bags that much, so that in by way would lead to those jobs being eliminated. And to go a little bit further on the debate, I just want to say that one thing I noticed about the how the debate proceeded and how it played out in the media was there is this primordial focus on the just how plastic bags are everywhere in the streets and getting caught in trees and fences. And this gets to something much more broader about just us as people. And we as people often weigh and react more to what is most apparent and most accessible to us, at least in a situation, in exchange or compared to factors that are less visible. It's much more of a hitting image to see plastic bags on the street as opposed to seeing water pollution that's being caused by paper bags, or even how recycled paper bags often take up a lot of fuel as well as far as their manufacturing process. And one last thing I want to say about this is that this tax that they're putting on people using plastic bags, it's come to my attention.
Taxes on paper bags.
On paper bags, excuse me. It's come to my attention that essentially this is a tax on the poor.
Yes.
It's a regressive tax where people who don't have transportation of their own will often have to take the bus, will have to carry these bags, and making it harder for them to transport things from the grocery store to home. And so that's something that was left out in the minds, I believe, of the people who crafted this ban.
And so essentially this is an unintended consequence of government policy set forth by Cam Gordon and the Minneapolis City Council.
I think that they didn't really consider this as one of the unintended consequences, because any policy you're going to put in place is going to have unintended consequences, and you want to minimize those as much as you can.
Okay. Now we're going to take a look. We discussed last week briefly on the plastics to oil technology. And what we're going to do is actually show the next two videos back to back. So Dallas, go ahead and just run one into the next one for the second one. We're going to show Agilex plastic to oil technology, and then we're going to go right after that to behind the scenes at Agilex, because this, I think, may be a possible solution. Market-based solution to plastic bags and other types of plastic wastes, instead of just saying, oh, we're going to ban plastic bags and we're going to just reshuffle around the consumer buying patterns. Let's take a look.
2 trillion pounds of waste plastic currently sits in U.S. landfills. Historically, the United States has exported another 4.3 billion pounds of waste plastic a year. Meanwhile, global demand for oil is expected to increase 50% by 2035. Thankfully, Agilex already has a proven solution. Our Generation 6 system is a next-life solution for waste plastic that is focused on the highest and best use for today and the future of our planet. It converts difficult-to-recycle plastics into high-grade synthetic crude oil. Agilex is the industry's first continuous feed and self-cleaning waste plastic solution. Each Agilex system can produce nearly 4 million gallons of crude oil a year, reducing our dependence on costly foreign oil and difficult to extract homeland reserves, while increasing regional energy independence with a substantially lower carbon impact. Agilex also helps preserve valuable space in our landfills and creates local jobs. The end result is valuable petroleum products for our daily lives and a more sustainable future for our planet. Learn more at agilex.com.
Hi, I'm Jeremy Carroll, reporter with Waste and Recycling News, and today we're in Beaverton, Oregon at Agilex. They're a startup company that is turning waste plastic into crude oil. And so today I'm with Lou Foyt. He's a senior account manager. And so tell us, Lou, a little bit about the technology and what you guys are doing here.
Great. Jeremy, we go after difficult to recycle waste plastic, And with our technology, companies that have a stream of that kind of feedstock that is either destined for the landfill or has little to no value in other streams can be incorporated into our system, and we will convert that waste plastic into crude oil that can then be sold to a refinery at NYMEX CL crude pricing.
And so how much of the waste plastic does it take to make a gallon of oil, crude oil?
Our starting system is a 20 ton per day system. So with 20 tons of waste plastic coming into the system a day, that will make 118 barrels or about 5,000 gallons of crude oil per day. We have a 10 ton per day production system. It runs 7 days a week, 24 hours a day. And we will see waste plastic going into vessels where it goes through a process of melting and then gasifying that plastic, goes into a condensing system that phase changes the plastic from a gas to back into a liquid. And the liquid and the condensing fluid are then separated, and the oil goes into a storage tank. The char is left at the end of the vessel, and a small amount of non-condensable gas is thermally destructed at the end of the process, resulting in a very low emissions profile for the entire technology.
Great. Well, I appreciate the time. Thank you.
Thank you, Jeremy.
So, Dr. Wyche, I just want to know what your opinion is and your thoughts to the video that you just saw. Is this technology that we can adapt to the Twin Cities?
Well, I would say that if this was done on a mass scale, maybe the U.S. would become an OPEC member. But questions I have about this are the quality of the crude oil that's made from this process versus crude oil that's taken directly from the ground.
Actually, I have an answer to that, and that happens to be our next video. Niagara Falls actually had introduced a similar system to this, and we're going to show you about their business opportunity and the refining process for, you know, the product that is created from this. So let's just go right to that video.
Imagine turning scraps of plastic into usable fuels. Some creative minds are making this idea into reality, and it's happening in Niagara Falls. Senior correspondent Rich Newberg is here with this news story tonight. Rich?
That's right, Jackie. Right now, 30 million tons of waste plastic in the U.S. goes to landfills. Plastic is made from oil, and now a company called JBI, based in Niagara Falls, has found a way to convert the plastic back to oil. This is no ordinary ribbon cutting. It may very well be the inauguration of a new era that converts waste plastic, like packaging from meat plants and scrap from auto factories, to usable gasoline, diesel fuel, home heating oil, and natural gas.
The fuel reproduces cleaner than the fuels currently found in industry due to the fact that plastics is already a highly refined hydrocarbon.
Plastic items we're all familiar with at home can become raw material for the process. The plastic is shredded first and then heated up into a gas. The processor, through a special catalyst, cracks the hydrocarbon chains in the plastic and separates out usable fuel.
There's your fuel there.
What is that?
That's it. This is heating oil right here. This is number two spec fuel oil.
It gets filtered and then pumped right into a tanker truck outside the plant. A factory in Canada will use this product to make plastic pipes. Niagara Falls is hoping the plastics to oil manufacturing process will expand and create more green jobs here.
Every waste hauler in the United States, Canada, and a lot of other places is going to want to have one of these units located on site, because now they can take plastic they would otherwise have to pay to landfill, and they can convert it into fuel to run their vehicles.
The creative development for the process started in this lab less than 2 years ago. A couple of pints of oil could be produced a day. The current plant produces 109 barrels a day. In two more years, the goal is to produce 20,000 barrels a day. And there's no shortage of plastic.
We received 18 pallets of these alone last week. About 40,000 pounds of these we received. That's a lot of plastic, but to us, it's a lot of fuel. This is 109 barrels of fuel, 4,400 gallons of diesel.
The natural gas produced is used to heat and run the process. JBI created 40 green jobs to run the plant in the falls. Reporting live, Rich Newberg, News 4 at 5:30.
And in case you're wanting to do the math, I've already done it for you. They said it takes 109 barrels per day. At the current price per barrel of CL1 WTI crude oil at $40.36 a barrel, which is what it closed at Friday on the market, that's $40.36 per barrel. That means they are generating $4,399.24 per day of oil, and from that, that turns into $1.6 million per year. Now, I have to say, I don't know what the price for the plant is, so there's definitely a payback over time. Your thoughts on what you just saw with Niagara Falls?
Well, if they're able to efficiently create their own oil, and if it reduces our own dependence on foreign oil, this would be a positive net gain from us if there was a way that this could be produced. And it would also solve the issue of what to do with all of this leftover plastic that accumulates in landfills and takes a long time to biodegrade.
So now if a company here was started up to do this, would you invest in it or consider it?
It would depend on what the laws were here locally over
good point.
That. So I would have to do an assessment on that first before jumping in.
All right, well, we are going to actually move on to another topic here because there's 39 more weeks before the next presidential inauguration, as President Obama will be leaving office and his replacement has not been anywhere close to being named yet. Last week we had the two Democrat nominees went in front of Al Sharpton's National Action Network. They had a conference or convention. And we're going to show you right now Hillary Clinton addressing the National Action Network.
White Americans need to do a much better job of listening when African Americans talk.
And we're going to actually have to play that over again because the video wasn't coming through. So let's try that again.
White Americans need to do a much better job of listening when African Americans talk about the seen and unseen barriers you face every day. We need to recognize our privilege and practice humility rather than assume our experiences are everyone else's experiences. I believe that Democrats have a special obligation. If we're going to ask African Americans to vote for us, we cannot take you or your vote for granted. We can't just show up at election time and say the right things and think that's enough.
So with that statement, now unfortunately, you know, because we're running out of time, I don't have a chance to show the whole hour. But when she's talking about practicing humility, does that look like a humble person?
I'll let the audience be your judge on that. Though what she did talk about is primarily, she was, from what I saw in it, is that that we need to be more aware of racism and disparities that we see in our community. But I will say this about disparities. Talking about disparities is one thing, and talking about structural barriers, but coming up with actual practical solutions to help eliminate those barriers and disparities, that's where a lot of people get lost in the weeds, and that's where the...
How so?
So, for instance, we see... I'll go back to the plastic bag ban. We see plastic bags everywhere, and so in our minds, we think that the biggest environmental hazard that revolves around bags or plastic bags being in the street, and obviously there's all these other factors that come into place with both paper bags and plastic bags. So why I'm relating that back is there tends to be often an over-conflation of the seeing disparity statistics and just automatically saying that this is entirely based out of racism. Now, I'm one to say that decades and decades and decades of racism have created the situation that we see in America now. For instance, I can give a personal story. In the Deep South, my grandfather, he was college educated, but after he finished college, the only work he could do was outside labor.
Do you remember what he got his degree in?
I believe it was in history.
Okay.
Yeah.
Well, as somebody who has a degree in history, I can tell you there are not that many jobs available out there for historians. And that's, you know, regardless of the color barrier, it's just there are just no jobs for historians, which is why I actually had to go into business, because that's where the jobs are.
But so as a result, he ended up started his own store.
So you got into business.
So yeah, he exactly did that. He went into business. And so I would say that I myself am lucky that I was able to escape the cycle of just living in a less fortunate state. But a lot of others didn't even have the opportunity to go to college for one reason or another. And so all of the stuff that we see now is a result of that. But then the question becomes, what can we do? Because there was a lot that was done during the 1960s, at least to eliminate institutional barriers, and that helped create the black middle class. But there is still a large segment of the black community that's been left behind. And ultimately, I'm not saying that racism in itself is like completely gone. We all know that racism still exists today, but if we expect to solve all of these disparities by just focusing primordially on racism, then we're going to continue to see the disparities that we see today. And so,
well, let's actually take a look at Bernie Sanders in front of the National Action Network.
And I know the National Action Network has been fighting this tooth and nail. And that is, we have a level of Republican voter suppression that is absolutely outrageous. You would have thought that after all we have gone through as a country to make sure that people have the right to vote, regardless of the color of their skin, that these Republican governors would show some mercy and not try to bring us back to Jim Crow days. The idea that they are passing laws restricting the right to vote, making it harder for people to vote, poor people, old people, people of color, that is moving in exactly the wrong way. Now I see my old friend Reverend Jackson here. He has an idea. Others have a different idea. But what we all agree on is at the end of the day, in America, if you are 18 years of age and you're an American citizen, you have the right to vote.
Well, Bernie says that the Republicans are trying to essentially suppress and bring back Jim Crow, but from my understanding, Republicans just really want to have clean and honest elections, and that there are plenty of opportunities for everybody to get the required IDs to vote, and they're trying to just close loopholes that are allowing multiple votes, felon voting. And so that is completely different than Bernie's suggestion of Republicans want to bring back Jim Crow because people don't want to go through a process to get an ID?
I think that's theatrics on Bernie's part, saying Republicans want to go back to Jim Crow, but this issue of voter ID is an example of, it seems like, solutions that have been put forward to address racial inequities have focused more on temporary band-aids that try to treat the symptoms of what we see as a result of these disparities, as opposed to actually tackling head-on why we have these disparities. And so one thing I want to say about this is it's like someone having a cough and going to the doctor and being prescribed Sudafed when they instead should be prescribed antibiotics, because what they really have is a bacterial infection. And so a lot of the stuff that I've seen during the campaign has revolved around things like criminal justice reform, which that's good in itself, but that doesn't address the fact why so many people of color are entering into the criminal justice system in the first place.
Good point.
And so we ultimately, what I believe is, if we want to see these massive gaps closed, especially here in Minnesota, because that's something that's often forgotten, because Minnesota ranks near the top in pretty much every statistic, but we rank
in every of which statistics?
Education, quality of life.
So you're talking overall compared to the other states?
Yes.
Okay.
But when it comes to racial disparities, we rank near or at the bottom.
Wow.
And even one study said that the Twin Cities, recent study said that the Twin Cities was the worst place in the country for blacks to live in.
Really?
And that was that was basically driven by those disparity stats that we see. And so what I believe is what's going to ultimately turn the needle on all of this is, I believe the great equalizer is a community that is, one, highly educated, and two, economically secure, because a lot of the disparities that we see, such as incarceration rates, Minnesota has probably the highest incarceration gap between blacks and whites too in the country.
Wow, I did not know that.
Yeah.
Well, let's take a look at one more video here, and this is another Bernie Sanders video. I'm not sure if this is at National Action Network or if it was somewhere else, but somebody asked him a question regarding slavery. So let's hear what Bernie Sanders said.
The United States has formally apologized for the internment of Japanese Americans during World War II and for subjecting black men to syphilis research during the Tuskegee experiment. But an American president has yet to muster up the courage to formally apologize for the 400 heinous years of rape, death, and inhumanity that occurred during the enslavement of black people in this country that still impacts millions of slave descendants. Senator Sanders, will you, if the next president of the United States, make that necessary and overdue apology?
You want the short answer? Yes. There's nothing that anybody can do to undo the deaths and the misery. How many people we don't even know who died on the way over here from Africa, the ships. Nobody, we cannot do that. But we have got to do everything that we can to wipe the slate clean, acknowledge truth. You know, truth is not always an easy thing. And a lot of things that we have done in this country that are shameful, and we've got to recognize that and own up to it. So the answer is yes.
What is your question for Senator Sanders?
Good afternoon, Senator Sanders. My name is Catherine Hicks. I'm with the Philadelphia Sunday Sun newspaper, which is an African-American publication, and the Pennsylvania State Democratic Black Caucus. And my question is, what is your view on the subject of reparations and the economic impact it could play in the African-American community, given the positive effect it has had in other economic groups?
Well, I think my view is pretty close to President Obama's, and that is, we understand the legacy of slavery. We understand that. And as I mentioned, and as everybody in this room knows, what we're seeing in many African American communities, outrageously high levels of unemployment, inadequate education, inadequate health care. And I think what we have got to do as a nation is invest in those communities who need that investment the most. And there's legislation introduced by some members of the Black Caucus, which I support, which takes a look at those communities around America which have long-term structural poverty issues, and they become the communities that receive the highest priority for federal funding. In other words, let us make sure that in every way, federal funding goes to those communities who need it the most. And in most cases, they'll be minority communities.
Senator Sanders brought up apologize for slavery and investing in the Black community, federal dollars. Now, at least the first one, apologizing for slavery, is that just not a Band-Aid fix? There are no more people who were slaves still alive in America.
You're right on that. I don't think an apology on slavery is a bad thing. I'd actually welcome it, but we'd also have to be mindful that that in itself won't be a fix. But on Sanders' statement on investing in a Black community, I believe there needs to be investment, but the investment needs to be more strategic.
How so? And
I think we need to invest in ways that provide a path for people to get out of poverty through education, training, business training. Ultimately, what's going to end up happening is that there needs to be more people in those communities that have a post-secondary education, for instance, because if you look here in Minnesota, the end of the decade, 3 out of every 4 jobs in this state are going to require some form of education or training beyond high school. And once we start seeing increased educational levels, we'll also start seeing increased employment levels, and then we'll start seeing reductions in crime and less run-ins with law enforcement. And the issue is why this is tough is because these are long-term investments. Mm-hmm. And it's easier, like I said again, about things being much more accessible. It's easy to focus in on things like reparations, which is a one-time quick fix, or talking about changing police procedure, that's another quick fix. But to get to addressing structural issues like the disparities that we see, it's going to take time over years to see that. And if we invest in money, if we invest money into things where we probably only see returns years in, I believe that's the best method. And going off of that, I believe if you educate the student, you also end up educating the child, because there's lots of research that shows if your parents went to college, you're going to go and be successful in college also. It's going to have effects well beyond even that initial investment.
We're going to show you two things that you've probably seen on mainstream TV for many, many, many years, and they're two familiar ads. Now let's take a look at them right now. We'll just run them back to back. They're each 30 seconds apiece. One came out last year, the first one, and then the other one came out back in 1980.
One day, when the glory comes, it will be ours.
Dr. King, what's your next move?
A march from Selma to Montgomery.
Selma is loud for every man, woman, and child.
We will not wait any longer.
In front of a crowd.
The Bodie Plantation was one of the largest cotton plantations in the country. Today on this very site is a United Negro College Fund member school, producing graduates who become doctors, lawyers, and chemists, and your contributions make theirs possible.
It took a lot to turn a cotton plantation into a college that plants the seeds of knowledge. Now let's get to work.
Give to the United Negro College Fund. A mind is a terrible thing to waste.
Now, we've heard for many, many, many decades, I think the UNCF was created, 1944, that the mind is a terrible thing to waste. Invest in the United Negro College Fund. They're giving scholarships to African Americans to go to college. And yet, the problems appear, at least through the media, to be widening. And yet, with all the money going to college educations, why are we seeing these problems?
Well, a lot of the refers to United Negro College Fund does a lot of great work. One problem with it is that most of the money goes to students who are at historically black colleges and universities, which are mainly located in the South. So hardly any students of color get UNCF money here in Minnesota. But
wow, I didn't know that.
But one of the issues that's been much more front and center regarding higher ed is that the access is only one part of the equation. Giving people tuition money to go to college is one thing, but often schools across the country, they do a good job of getting students in, but do a horrible job of getting them out. And
wow.
And I believe that there needs to be a much bigger much bigger focus in on looking at how the internal institutions of colleges are set up for people from non-traditional backgrounds who are coming to their doors more and more. For instance, right now in Minnesota, one out of every four students at a college is a person of color, and that's going to only keep increasing. And so ultimately, more focus will have to go with looking at what happens to the students after they go into college, because we hear this in the campaign a lot with Bernie talking about free college or Hillary talking about first 2 years of community college free. Well, in Minnesota, we essentially have free community college if your income is low enough to qualify. And yet, we are still seeing these results that are coming where in Minnesota, we're ranked number 34 as far as community college graduation rates, which
wow.
is below the national average. So only focusing on access is a mistake, but you have to focus on not just access, but also making sure students don't drop out and progress on to their degree.
Well, Dr. Shaun Williams-Wyche from Metropolitan State University, thank you for coming today. We're going to have to bring you back and discuss some more possible solutions. This, I think we've just only touched the tip of the iceberg today. And so thank you again for coming on North Star Oasis.
Thank you very much, Jeff.
And as we try to leave you with a musical number of the week, and usually we go through military bands, we're going to leave you today with the U.S. Army Band. And here we go.
Go tell it on the mountain, over the hills and everywhere. Go tell it on the mountain that Jesus Christ is born.
All right, now come on, put your hands together, come on.
The mountain, over the hills and everywhere. Go and tell it on the mountain that Jesus Christ is born.
And that's our show for the week. Thank you for watching. We'll see you next week. North Star Oasis.
Our shepherds kept their watching o'er silent flocks by night. Behold, among the heavens shown a whole